Yeah,
what Gooden had about, what, 7 shots at it? If the strike zone was high and outside, he'd be in the Hall of Fame. you've got better control than that.
You think so?
I bet you could hit it in 6 throws. I bet you could.
The camera?
Yeah, the camera. That's easy. It's only 60 feet away.
See, I would have thought so before I saw Dwight Gooden not get a direct hit in about 6 or 7.
But you know what? He was easing up. I think if he had rocked back and really thrown one, he'd have blistered that thing. Don't you? I mean,
have you ever, in all your years as a sportscaster doing baseball, did you ever see equipment destroyed like that? Or
in a clubhouse. Yeah, in a clubhouse.
Yeah, when guys go nuts and stuff.
Yeah,
sure.
And they really do totally destroy it.
But foul balls ever get into the equipment, off a microphone or a camera?
Do you ever see a game in Tiger Stadium?
No, I've never been there.
In Detroit? Yeah. Well, the Tiger Stadium for a broadcaster in the old days was the most intimate of all the ballparks. And the radio booth, when I did the Angel games, set off the facing of the second deck and looked right down on the catcher. You're about 35 feet away from the catch. You could hear the conversations at home plate sometimes. And foul balls off a left-handed hitter would carry them right up. And it was not uncommon for a ball to fly through, break the lights. We'd be working in glass. And it was, in fact, Ernie Harwell, a friend of yours, I finally put a whole screen in front of his booth because of the danger.
You want to talk about that for a second? Ernie Harwell, now here is a guy, first of all, they're going to tear down Tiger Stadium.
Yeah, that's
one of the great parks left. They got rid of Comiskey Park, put up almost an identical version across the street, right?
Right.
So now, but for the money
it's falling apart.
Yeah, but for the money it cost them to put up the new one, why couldn't they repair the old one? That's my point.
It would cost... I agree with you. I'm a romantic. An architect.
Was an architect. A structural engineer. Woo!
One of those cranes in a big bowl, right, huh? It would cost as much to build a new ballpark as to fix the old ballpark and still have an old ballpark, and that's the problem.
But for heaven's sakes, an old ballpark, I mean, that's really something. Tiger Stadium, really something. Fenway, Wrigley Field.
There are only a few left. And the new ones are really sterile. I agree with you.
But I understand the new Comiskey Park is very nice. People tell me that it's not. No, I've not been there either. And then Ernie Harwell, who has been the voice of the Tigers for how many years? 4 decades?
Well, let's see, probably first in the 50s, I think.
Yeah.
One of the great men in our profession and a terrific broadcaster, and certainly age hasn't hindered his talent a bit. He is Detroit Tiger baseball, and of course it was a tremendous uproar when it was announced that this would be his last
year, not by his choice, but
by management.
They're going to tear him down and build a new announcer.
They won't build one like Ernie Harwell. No. They'll not build another
But, you know, I heard him on the radio here in New York a couple of days ago. This guy sounds just as fit and full of energy as a guy, you know, in his 30s or 40s.
Yeah, it's a shame.
Yeah.
You know, can I tell you a story that reminded me of the Gooden and Tiger Stadium? One of the biggest thrills I ever had was calling a Nolan Ryan no-hitter in Detroit. And here Ryan's still pitching and has well over 5,000 strikeouts.
This is when he was an angel, right?
Yeah. 1973, it was his second no-hitter. And in Detroit, in that intimate park where you could just hear the ball slamming into the mitt. In the 6th inning, Norm Cash, who was a batting champion at one time, came up, no-hit going, and Ryan striking out one batter after another. He had a 1-strike count on him before the umpire realized that Cash had gone back in the clubhouse, taken a leg off a table, and was up at home plate with a table leg, and the umpire finally with 1 strike on him said, "Cash, you can't be up here without a bat." And he says, "I'm not going to hit him anyway. What difference does it make?" And he didn't.
That's great. See, Paul, that's what I'm talking about. In the old days, 3 pitchers and a piece of furniture. The rules were much different then. And again, you just had another successful couple of weeks over there at Wimbledon. I know that must be one of your favorite events. I know that for a fact.
I mean, romantically, it is my favorite. And there's something about it that makes me want to write poetry. No, I'm serious. I don't write good poetry, but I fall in love with it. I mean, there are some events that you like to do and you enjoy and it's exciting. A Super Bowl game is incredibly exciting, but it's madness and it's only one game. Wimbledon's a 2-week experience, and it's men and women both wanting to win this championship, and it's the Brits, and it's the weather, and it's the history, and you really get caught up in it.
Have you made a list of words that rhyme with Wimbledon?
At least you say it right. At least you say it right. It's not Lutton.
Oh, I don't get
Wimpleton.
That. Wimpleton. Oh, I don't get that. Why do these people, who are supposedly sports announcers, men and women, why do they put a T in there? There's no T in there, is there?
No, it's a D, Wimbledon.
Wimbledon, but what do you hear over and over and over again?
What, you tell me.
Wimbledon.
That's right.
Yeah. But shouldn't somebody, there must be a memo or something that could go out?
Can I tell you a cute little story this year? With all the rain, you know, we had a tremendous amount of rain. And the Brits love to queue up. I mean, you get two people, you know, one behind another, and another 50 will line up behind them thinking it's something to do. It's their national pastime. They love to queue. And so outside of center court, if you only have a grounds pass and not a ticket to center court, you can wait, and you can wait all day. And eventually when someone inside decides they've seen enough tennis, they will leave their ticket with an usher, and for 50 cents or 75 cents, money goes to charity, tennis charity. Then you, if you've been waiting in line, you can get in. Well, it's raining. There's no chance they're going to play. And
right.
These people are waiting patiently outside all day long. And there were these two beautiful old ladies, I would say in their 70s, 80s. And I kept passing by them, and my curiosity finally got to them. And I said, how would you know but what the way I walk by you that I'm just going to the front of the line? You're waiting all day, and I'm going right in.
Mm-hmm.
And this one woman raised her eyebrow, and she said, young man, she said, do you realize the damage we could do with these umbrellas? And I had this vision of these two women just beating the heck out of a guy trying to cut through the line.
Oh, man. Oh, is that a recurring dream?
Rough night. This is a rough night.
Oh, I know. It's a tough night.
It's your collar.
Oh, I don't know what's the matter with this damn collar. Hey, hang around here. We're not done talking. Can you stick around a second? Okay, we'll be right back here with Dick Enberg. Videotape, pal. We're going back up to Shea Stadium, Dick.
Okay.
I want you to call the action here, and I understand.
They're going to do it again.
I don't know.
Again?
I don't know exactly what this tape is, but just roll it. I don't know who this is, but
well, that's close range.
Yeah.
That's a second baseman.
Oh, there. That was Keith Miller, I'm told.
Ah.
That's a little cheating there. Where the heck were we? Oh, Monica Seles. What's the deal there? What was that? What was that all about?
Well, we'd all like to find out. Here's the number one player in the world. She's won the Australian, the French Open, halfway to a rare Grand Slam. And Wimbledon comes by, and she excuses herself with no apparent reason at the time, and then was silent until just this last couple of days. I think it's an embarrassment for women's tennis. I think she owed it as the top player to her game to let people know why she wasn't going to compete in the most prestigious tournament in tennis.
You know what I think, Dick?
What?
I think she's yellow.
I thought you were going to tell me that you had some insight from Donald Trump.
I don't know.
You know, Donald Trump's involved in this thing, you know.
Oh, my God. He's involved in everything, this guy.
Yeah.
All right, well, let's go back. Monica Seles, how old is she?
Where
17. She 17. They just keep coming. I mean, I remember when it was Tracy Austin, when she was like 15, 16, 17, there's always a 15 or a 16-year-old kid who comes along and then dominates tennis for a few years.
Well, and especially on the women's side, I think in most of the sport, gymnastics and tennis being two examples, a young girl, 15, 16, 17, can compete where a man would have to be 22, 23, 24 to be at that same level. The problem is, though, at 17, we have these multimillionaires. They almost own their own little duchy, and they have people who cater to them who are afraid to give them good, mature advice for fear that the 17-year-old millionaire will fire them not agreeing with them.
Yeah.
So no one says anything to them, so they get no good advice.
So did you ever find out what it was? I guess there was shin splints. Is that what we heard?
They said a stress fracture and a... and shin splints, and we'll see how she plays. She's playing this week here in New Jersey.
Yeah, but she should have announced or should have given that as a reason immediately.
Absolutely.
I mean, when you withdraw from Wimbledon.
Absolutely. I mean, what would happen if you just suddenly didn't show up? And,
and here
we are waiting for you.
Like, who would notice?
I would notice. I'd notice.
Now, the other thing, I saw you guys, you did a piece about Bjorn Borg. Now, when I used to follow tennis, and I used to play a lot of tennis, and I knew a lot about the sport, this guy was, you couldn't touch him. You couldn't go anywhere near this guy. He was... especially men's tennis, and now it's turned into kind of like something. Do we feel sorry for the guy now?
Well, I feel sorry for him. He's a man that reportedly made $75 million and has lost most of it in bad investment deals. Does that sound familiar? I mean, that's so many of the athletes get involved, make a lot of money, trust somebody to invest it, and it doesn't work out well. He's had a lot of trouble with marriages and relationships with females in his life, and he now realizes 10 years too late that was really the time of his life where he was happiest playing tennis, and now it's too late to call back that kind of talent.
But is the comeback on now, or is the comeback off?
I think he realizes that probably the best he could be is an exhibition player. He can't compete on the same level. I mean, Connors and McEnroe have done it because they've stayed in the game.
They stayed with the game, sure. Yeah.
And he just is, and he was as good as anyone I've ever seen play.
Yeah, it's just too bad, because nothing would be greater to see this guy, you know, you don't think he's going to win a major tournament, but get past the first or second round.
We want our heroes to come back and thrill us again.
Exactly. Oh, by the way, Dick, your salad is here.
What kind of dress?
Well, I don't know. We have something here. Oh, this is nice. Look at that. Make your own. So, are you off for the summer now before football begins?
Well, football begins right around the corner.
Oh, yeah, that's right. All right. Well, good. Always a pleasure to have you here.
Good to
stop
see you
by any time. Dick Enberg, kids. We'll be right back.